fabulous programs like this. And don't forget to look at our exhibition on our way out on Sarah Jessica Parker, one of our biggest benefactors who made it possible to buy this beautiful building. And it's a great pleasure to welcome Jim Grissom tonight. While I was running Lenox Hill Bookstore, he worked in a neighboring bakery and often brought us delicious treats. He is a great reader, and I love talking to him about what books we were reading, along with a lot of other more superficial topics that we discussed. I also loved hearing about the book he was working on, about Tennessee Williams, my adored favorite playwright. And I was hoping the Society Library had some connection to Tennessee Williams, but I could not find one. But we do have 57 copies of his books, which indicates that our members like him very much. The book Follies of God described Jim's relationship with Tennessee Williams and his quest to find out for Williams if his work had mattered. I was thrilled to get an early galley of the book and was blown away by the gorgeous, sensuous prose and fascinating interviews with many of the women Williams had been close to. I've rarely seen such rapturous reviews as of this book. Michael Cordett said, Grissom has at last brought to the printed page some of the magic that radiated from Tennessee, even in his saddest moments, and explained so much more than we ever knew about the fierce, charming, and curiously evasive personality of America's greatest playwright. And then this from Jane Alexander. Grissom magically captures the voice of Tennessee in this beautifully written book about the actresses in his plays. Would that I had been one of them. There is no greater American playwright, and Follies of God reveals why. Jim was born in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, and attended LSU and the University of Pennsylvania. He has written for Homefront, I'll Fly Away, Will and Grace, Sex in the City, and many other shows. He is now working on a book about his phone conversations with Marlon Brando. And now, let us welcome Jim Grissom.
Tennessee Williams wanted more than anything to find out if he had mattered, which to those of us who love his plays, and when he told me that when I was 20, I couldn't imagine that this man, 50 years older, to whom I'd written a letter asking advice and admired so much, thought so little of himself. Now that I'm older and have interviewed all these people he told me to go interview, I realize everyone, or most people, feel the same way. They wonder, what was it all about? Quote a song from the 60s, but they don't know if they really clicked. That was a term Maureen Stapleton used. She was referencing Katharine Hepburn, but she always said, well, maybe I didn't matter either. I don't know. Marlon Brando said the two of the most important things that we have to do in our lives is knowing where to look and knowing when to stop. And being young and really wanting to extend all conversations with people like this, I would always say, what do you mean? He said, well, if you go into anything, a relationship, a part in a play, a restaurant, anything, and you say, oh, I'll walk in there and I'll meet the love of my life, or I'll do this play and I'll win an award, you're doomed, because that is probably not what's going to happen. And so you're tempting fate, because fate might have something better worked out for you. But you're perpetually going to be dissatisfied with what was provided because it wasn't in your design. So he said, you have to know where to look. So when you say things to yourself like, I didn't get this, you have to also have a correlative list of what you did get and what you have. And you have to also know when to stop. And he didn't mean a suicidal ideation, like it's time to put a bullet in your head or end it all. But certain things need to be shifted. And there might be a time when you have to stop wearing culottes, or you might the low-cut shirt with the chains. No, stop dyeing your hair. You know, the black hair, he was talking about himself. Like, you know, like, just, I'm bald, handle meant so much to me, and I think to a lot of people who care about acting. And he wasn't happy at all. He was this man in a caftan, walking around his house on Mulholland Drive, calling me, a copy editor at Penthouse. He would help me come up with synonyms for ejaculate. And he said that only two things in my life have never disappointed me: eating and sleeping. And so he would call me and he'd say, "It's 10:30 in Los Angeles. Will you talk to me until it's 12:30? And I'd say, "I'll talk to you all night." Mm-hmm. "Well, no, just 2 hours. I think if I talk to you for 2 hours, I won't eat the cake in the kitchen." So we had this bargain, and you know, he said, "It's just food. You know, none of it meant anything." I said, "None of the films or the plays meant anything?" "No." But he was figuring out a way to fix that. And that was why I think he could talk to a Rube like me, because I was trying to get situated. Who am I? What am I going to do? What am I going to do when I grow up? He was asking the same questions of himself, earning his place on this planet, and what was he going to do? Tennessee and I also had a lack of faith in that we both went to the dark place. So if the phone didn't ring, it meant I'll never work again. Everyone has turned against me. Tennessee had lived long enough for Facebook, there's that shattering defeat when you don't get the friend request accepted. It's like, is word out on me? What is this about? You know? And then the work when you get unfriended, like, what did I say? But I think we all live in that, you know. But my good friend Francis Sternhagen is a beacon of positivity. And she had this philosophy. She had six children. She lived in New Rochelle. She still lives in New Rochelle, still has six children. I don't mean to imply that, but she's not raising them any longer. And would work all the time and give wonderful performances. And her children have all told me this. They would all pile in a station wagon and back out of their driveway and get to the end of the street where they lived. And she would say, without any irony or unctuousness, she'd turn around to her kids and say, "Even if this vacation ends now, I've had a wonderful time." And Tennessee knew that about her, and that's why he sent me to her. But the real thing, and this is really on my mind now, because there was a wonderful editorial today in the New York Times by Nicholas Kristof. I don't know if you saw it. And I think more people are afraid of having their sensibility offended than of hungry people on the street, or are going to war, or unemployment, although unemployment's down, but they're more, even when it was high, they were more concerned with, "Your statement offended me," and they want heads to roll. And one of the things Tennessee and I talked about in that Pleistocene era of 1982 was that he would not take away any of the pain that he had endured as a child. Because he said, "I think that pain was like the sand in an oyster. And I was able to write. And I was able to have a career as a writer, and to write plays, and to write short stories and novels. And that's a great gift." So if I was called sissy or faggot most every day of my young life, then I can deal with that. Maureen Stapleton said that as a child, she grew up in a home of Irish women who drank and bitched about men and what they had done to them, because most of them had left. And so what they found refuge in the drinking and the radio dramas and going to movies. And Maureen said, I couldn't change that, because it was so magical to go into those movie theaters and those beautiful black and white RKO movies. And I always believed this little fat girl from Troy, New York was gonna get up there somehow. And it propelled me. And I can't imagine what would have happened if I had an easy life. You know, I mean, and when she was speaking to me, she was, "Well, now I'm drunk, and I shouldn't be a drunk." She had this joke that all of her friends and I talked about when I went to Lenox to see her. She was only drinking two drinks a day, but about this big. I mean, it was worse than the Elaine Stritch joke about drinking out of vases from Bloomingdale. I mean, and it's only Blue Nun, which, and I'm thinking, I think that's still alcohol. still wouldn't rescind any of the unhappiness that she had. And I don't know, I mean, there's so many things that offend me, as I'm sure offend you, but I would never want to take away the right of someone to say that. I mean, unless it was like, let's go kill these people who think like that. But this keeps happening, and Tennessee was afraid of it in the early 80s because he said, the theater is becoming so bland. And what these educated people are doing is they're typing. And he would go to see these plays by these Yale darlings, and he'd say, there is nothing big at stake. I mean, I don't want to see a play about some overweight girl wondering if she'll ever get married. You know, that to me is not huge. It doesn't speak to everyone. But maybe if the overweight girl wanted to get married before she died, you know, and she had a tumor and it was pressing on her brain, and the tumor made her think she was Maria Callas. Now we're getting a play. You know, now we're getting a conflict. So he would sit and talk about all the plays he'd recently seen and say, well, here's what I would do to it. And then it became a game. He'd say, well, here's what Edward Albee would do to it. And here's what Lanford Wilson would do to it. So he said, why is nothing at stake any longer? And I chalked it up at that time, being 20 years old, to his bitterness that he wasn't being produced as often. And he was very upset about the fact that he had once been on Broadway and had won Pulitzer Prizes and was now being done in church basements. And he'd be done on Broadway and close very quickly. And he just was upset that people didn't want to hear what he had to say any longer. But he also said, apropos of Marlon Brando, maybe it's time for me to stop. But there was enough faith in him and ego that he said, no, it's not time yet. I'm going to keep writing. And it's September. It was September when we met. This is the time of year when we all get new books. We're going back to school. We start all over. A fresh pad of paper, a fresh incentive. And he was going to try to give up the drugs and stop drinking and really get back to work. And that was when I met him. And he said, so they're telling me all the time that I don't matter. But I can't be bitter, because then I'll never get to work. I'll just be in a rage all the time. So I focus on those people, those plays, those places that matter to me. And I'm going to give you their names. And I thought, well, okay. So I started writing the names on the menu of the restaurant where we were eating. And then he said, well, I can find a better way for you to remember this. So he took me to St. Louis Cathedral, where he had converted to Catholicism, and there was a gift shop, and he bought me this rosary. And a comic scene ensued because this woman, who looked very much like Cloris Leachman, it was a part Cloris Leachman play. She was very pinched and so forth, and Tennessee was thinking, what kind of book should I buy for Dixie, which is what he called me. And he said, well, I'll get you Imitation of Christ. And she went, I wouldn't get that, it's anti-humanist. So she was that type, she was a zealot. And she didn't want to sell Tennessee this rosary because the Christ is missing. It had fallen off. You could see where it was probably hanging. And it wasn't in the bag, and it just wasn't. She said, I can't sell this, it's a defective rosary. And Tennessee went, it's perfect. I don't want a rosary with a Jesus hanging on it. This means he's already out on the road working. So this became an argument, and he finally bought it for me. But then I was raised a Southern Baptist. When he handed me this, I held it like, what do I do with this? And so I didn't know the sacrilege he was committing by saying, this bead is Lillian Gish. This bead is Maureen Stapleton. And the woman was, her head was about to. So he renamed all these. He also reworded the Our Father. I mean, the whole thing, which to me was wrong. I had to write it all down. And so we went into St. Louis Cathedral. He lit a candle for Maureen Stapleton and gave me this. And I thought that was the end of our day. But he said, I'll see you in a moment. Okay. So I went back and we spent 5 days together. And then we had a few phone calls after that. That 5 days, and I kept thinking, what does he want me to do? And I asked him once, what is it you really want me to do? And he goes, well, I want you to go to these ways. and asked them if I had mattered. And he kept buying little gifts for them. He bought like a candle that had the shape of a crucifix carved out of it, so that when you lit the candle, it threw a cross on the wall. And he wanted that to go to Elaine Stritch. She said, "Jesus Christ, scared the hell out of me." But she kept it. I mean, he bought funny things for some people and odd, crazy things for them. But he bought a rosary that was made in Jerusalem for Mary and Zelda's. She's butt Jewish, you know. I don't think a Jew would be less offended by a rosary because it was made in Jerusalem. Anyway, she loved it, carried it with her all the time. But I couldn't figure out how to do this assignment. And he was ready for me to come to New York. He said, "I'm going to leave New Orleans, go right back to New York. You can come up. I can get you a room at the Hotel Easy Lay, as he called it. You can stay at Manhattan Plaza with me." And I went, but I also couldn't imagine knocking on Julie Harris's door, or anyone, Estelle Parsons, especially Estelle Parsons, and asking, "Hello, you don't know me, but did Tennessee Williams matter to you?" I mean, I just think I would have been run out of town. I just really didn't. But I was also, and this is the guilt part of this, because when Tennessee was giving me the names of all these women, he came to the name Marion Seldes. And I said, "Well, I know her already." And he couldn't believe, like, how does this yahoo from Baton Rouge, Louisiana, I know Marion Seldes already? On my high school drama club trip in 1978, we would come up for Thanksgiving week and see 8 plays and stay at the Hotel Edison. Lovely play. And they used to be a porno theater across the street from the Edison. And the movie they were playing was Roller Babies. That's what I remember. But one of the plays we went to see was Death Trap at the Music Box Theater, in which Marion appeared for 5 years without ever missing a performance. When I met Tennessee, she had been in it for 4 years without ever missing a performance, which Tennessee said, "Well, that's insanity." But he said, "You know Marion?" I went, "Yeah." He goes, "Well, I trust her implicitly." What I didn't know is he went right back to his hotel room at the Royal Orleans and called Marion in New York to get a reference on me. Like, is this kid okay? And she went, "Yes, he's lovely." And then, of course, she called me. Why am I getting a phone call at 11 o'clock at night from Tennessee Williams? So she said, "You have to do this. You have to finish this task. But I also understand that you don't know how." Because Tennessee was lovely, and we had these incredible conversations that were deep and philosophical and also hysterically funny. Jeanette says we used to talk about superficial things. So did Tennessee and I. So we would talk about the writers we love, the actresses we love. We would also talk about songs that we were going to have. This is 1982, bear with me. Songs we were going to have placed on a reel-to-reel tape and play to get people out of our houses. So he said, "What would you put on your tape?" And I will tell you, we both had the same number one song. But so he said, "You know what song I hate?" And Tennessee and I would do imitations all day long, which is why I think he put up with me, because he would say, "Do Geraldine Page again," and I'd do Geraldine Page. And he'd do Maureen, and I'd do Maureen. Do Katharine Hepburn. All right. But the song he hated, and it really will drive you crazy, he goes, "That song makes me suicidal." And you all know this song. It's "Please Come to Boston." Do you know this song?
Yeah.
Yeah. So Tennessee would say, "Have a seat, Carol." So good. But it was this Kenny Loggins song, and he says, it's the whining about it that I hate, but it's like, do you know this song? It's like, "Please come to Boston." Like, he goes, "Why would you beg somebody to come to you?" But the number one song that would drive anyone insane, or most importantly, out of your apartment, was the record The Edmund Fitzgerald by Gordon Lightfoot. A 6-minute song about a ship that sank in Lake Michigan. And it was a hit. And Tennessee went, "I can't get a play produced and this is a hit." But anyway, so we would talk about things like that. And I would say to Marion, "Well, we had those great times, those funny times, but he was also drinking heavily and using drugs. And I always knew where my car was when I was in New Orleans." So there were times when Tennessee would start talking and I would think I had had a stroke. Mm-hmm. So I would look around for a waiter to say something to me, because his voice would be, had a stroke, or I've had a stroke, but it was because he'd had so much to drink, and the drugs had hit him, had kicked in, that he was incomprehensible. Well, then that was the time to take him back to the hotel for me to get in my car. And I didn't know how to handle New York if I was his guest. And so Marion and I were planning ways that I could do this when he died. So he died 5 months after I met him. And then I thought, well, it's over. You know, what am I going to do? I can't go, hey, Kathy, come sit by the good-looking friend. This is Kathy Zuckerman, my publicist, who is a saint and a savior. And this is Stephen Dexter. And this is Jeanette, and this is Kathy. Okay, so would everyone like to meet Kathy? But everyone should. And I'm trying to figure out what to do with this. And my father said, a very righteous Southern Baptist, but not in a hateful way, he said, I think you have to honor what someone asks you to do. See, it's like, I'm a gay man. I will probably cry, but I will not sing, I'm still here. I'm sorry. That's about it. So my father gave me the money and said, go to New York. He may want me out of the house. But anyway, so I came to New York. Marion said, let's have lunch. And I said, okay. So she took me to the coffee house club. And she sat and she took out this purse, this huge purse, which was not, she always had a nice purse. This was a tacky purse. It was very unlike Marion. But she took this huge purse out and dumped all these letters I've been sending her for years with things that Tennessee had said about other actresses, about writing, about himself. And she said, this is a book, and you have to do it. And I said, I don't know how. And she goes, you find out how in doing. And she goes, now what can I do? And I go, well, for starters, how do I find these people? Tell me who you need. So it was Marion who called Julie Harris, Alec Guinness, John Gielgud, Irene Wirth, Edward Albee, John Guare, all these people. And suddenly, in my little rent-stabilized apartment, my phone started ringing, and these people were on the phone. Sometimes a bit incredulous, but what is this assignment? What do you want to know about Tennessee Williams? I'll do anything for Tennessee. And then I just kept showing up and going to talk to them and interview them and asking over and over again, what do you mean when you say that? And I didn't want them really to end. So like when Jeanette and I met up again, that was 2004, I was still working on it. I mean, and I part of me was very frustrated, and I'm sure my editor was frustrated, because I just didn't want this to end, because we're back to taking offense in life and looking for the right things. And also, gratitude is so, we've cheapened gratitude, because everyone on Facebook is hashtag gratitude, without really looking at what gratitude is. And it's easy to think, oh, I worked on this book, and I don't know if it's any good or whatever. And then you have to shift the angle, as Tennessee used to always say about faith. And I shift the angle and I go, look who I got to talk to. It's remarkable that I got to spend all this time with these great figures of the American theater. That Marlon Brando called me, you know, even like a 2-minute phone call to say, I have the perfect term for ejaculate, which I won a contest at Penthouse. Later I'll tell you what the term is. But, I would lose sight of that. I didn't know where to look, as Marlon Brando said. I kept looking like, will the book come out? Will the book be a bestseller? You know, will the book get good reviews? Will people care about the book? And that's looking in the wrong place. The thing is to write the book. Do the best you can. Harold Pinter told me his holy trinity was, give everything, expect nothing, move on. And I'm working on it. So you just pour everything into it, and that's it. You've done everything you can, and you move on to the next project. And Tennessee had never learned how to do that. Tennessee was revising Streetcar when I met him. He says, I think I can get the last few scenes just right. It's being produced as we speak somewhere. He was never satisfied with it. He never thought that he had really done all that he possibly could with any of his work. And so I, so So what the book really was for me was to be a witness to him, because he kept saying, be my witness. Find out if I ever mattered, if any of my work had any relevance. Be that witness for me. Be there for me. You know, and he kept referring to the reference in the Bible when Jesus said to his disciples, could you not wait 1 hour for me? And Tennessee used to like to go into Catholic churches. Why? I don't know. Because he rewrote all of their catechism. But anyway, he would go into Catholic churches for the perpetual adoration, where the exposed host, which you say is not an inward all day, but the exposed host is there, and people sit in its presence, and they pray, and they meditate. And he would like go in there, and he would say, they're serving as a witness to this great sacrificial act that took place. And I don't think he compared himself to Jesus, but he wanted someone, anyone, to say, we're glad you wrote these plays. We're glad that we have the opportunity to read them and reproduce them. So I would hope that that is something that I've managed to do in the book while having a lot of fun along the way. Because the biggest surprise for me, I think, was that Tennessee was so funny. Because I had read his plays and they're very tragic, very dramatic, dark. I had read about his life and the alcoholism and the depression and so forth. And we laughed so much. And when I would talk to people who'd known him for years, they'd say, oh, he's one of the funniest people in the world. And it was so joyous to be with him. And he said, so all of this, because I can't deny or begrudge any of the tragedy or the depression I've had, because it made me capable of being alive. And what makes me capable of being alive? And I think the writing came from the father who beat me and sent me to my room, and I had a radio, and I could listen to the dramas on the radio, and I would think, I can do that. And if he punished me and took away the radio, I could open the window and listen to the neighbors and try to imagine, what is the drama there? Who are the characters in that scene? And it saved me. And Elizabeth Taylor said, when I was first growing up, my mother was a Christian Scientist, and I lived by the dictates of Mary Baker Eddy. And that was, God did not create sin, disease, or death, therefore they don't exist. So there I was, 3 or 4 years old, someone would fall down and skin their knee. That didn't happen. God did not ordain that. So get up and let's get back to work. And then I became a devotee of the dictates of Louis B. Mayer. So then it was like, wear makeup all the time, stand up straight, comb your hair, and don't be seen with Mickey Rooney. And I just went right into that. You find these ways to function. And of course, she later found a better way to function. She converted to Judaism. And she always told me, for Mike Todd, not for Eddie Fisher. I never did anything notable for Eddie Fisher. And she couldn't get it. She couldn't figure out how Judaism worked. You know, she said, if it had been a clock, I would have kept opening the back of it, like to see what's in here, what's going on. And I was renouncing the New Testament and learning all this history. And she goes, I didn't know how to apply this to my daily life. Until my Todd took her to a function that a family was having, and they just had a child. And for a while, it was just a very nice gathering of people recognizing this birth, holding this baby, and then suddenly the baby was taken from person to person, and each person was asked to hold it and to look at it. And there was a rabbi there, and he began speaking. And she said, and what he was saying was, we are now all responsible for this child. You are now all of its family. It was essentially the village that it took, that it might take, to take care of this child. And she went, and then I got it. That became what I lived for. And so I was always looking for the child that would be handed to me. And eventually it was the AIDS crisis, because suddenly all my friends were sick or dying. And so when I met Elizabeth Taylor, another lover of Tad, at the Carlisle Hotel, I walked in. She was arrayed on this sofa, very movie star-like. Her pinched acolyte opened the door. I walked in with a can of Tad. She broke the movie star composure to go, Tad! And immediately said, well, we're going to be great friends. And she hopped up and showed me her refrigerator, just full of Tad. So we were friends. said, I need to go somewhere. And then she paused and said, I want you to come with me. So she looked fabulous. She put on some real hurt me pumps, looked very much like Elizabeth Taylor, put her dog Sugar, you know, under her arm, and we went out. We went to the Bronx. We went to a clinic / hospital for AIDS patients. Now, this was 1991, and they were all really sent there to die. And they were just, I had never seen people this ill. And you can imagine their response when Elizabeth Taylor walked in. And so one guy went, honey, your hair's too high. And she went, you think? Yeah. You want me to fix it? Yeah. And Elizabeth Taylor handed me the dog Sugar and sat on the floor and let this man, who'd been a beautician, fix her hair. And she went and she hugged everybody, talked to them, told them stories. Is it true what they say about so-and-so? Oh, God, yeah. I mean, gossiped with them, held them. Most of them had been abandoned by their families. And so Elizabeth said to me, ask them for the names of their mothers. And I thought, she's going to kick some ass. That's what she's going to do. She's going to call them, like, how dare you? So I went, and I had your mother's name, where she lived, whatever. Gave it to Elizabeth. Didn't think anything of it. We're in the car heading back. And I said, are you going to call these mothers? You bet. Or they'll call me. Were you going to really tell them what horrible mothers they are? No. I'm going to wait for them to be aware of what they've done, and they're going to need me, and I'm going to help them too. So, I mean, this is not this jewel-obsessed, shallow woman that a lot of people, you know, are painting. You know, the portrait they're painting of Elizabeth Taylor, she really gave herself to this. Irene Diamond once told me that Elizabeth Taylor was in a clinic, and she said, this place is filthy. You've got to fix this place. And they said, we don't have the money. And she took a ring off and gave it to them. Said this should cover it. I mean, so there's a lot that hasn't been said or written or appreciated about Elizabeth Taylor. But anyway, she was terrific. That was her goal in life. And I think when Tennessee met me, he was trying to find another way, another set of patterns. He was very big on this many steps or this many ways to do certain things. And I think I'm still on that same path, but I don't know. Does anybody have any questions or ejaculations, exultations? Yes.
How did you get involved with Marlon Brando?
There was an actress I interviewed for Follies of God. Her name is Barbara Baxley. And Barbara was always after Marlon to talk to me. She'd say, you've got to talk to this kid. He's doing this book. And he'd say, I don't want to do that. I'm so sick of talking to people. You know, I have nothing to say. And then I used to go over to Barbara's house about 3 times a week. I would buy her Merit cigarettes, and we'd go talk, and she'd tell me everything. And I went, and she had died. So her good friends Dave and Ole Brubeck and I put together a memorial service. And Marlon was in Los Angeles. He wasn't going to be able to come. But suddenly my phone rang at 2 in the morning, and it was Marlon Brando. And he said, I feel terrible that I never honored Barbara's request, and that I let you down and her down. So what are you doing? You want to talk? And I thought I would get that one night, and then it was right around the time Christian Brando was arrested for murder. A lot of people ask me, and rightly so, why they talk to you? I think there are two reasons, or are two primary reasons. They were honoring Tennessee, whom they loved, and about whom many of them had varying degrees of guilt. And the second one was, a lot of them just needed someone to talk to, and I had all the time in the world. It was like, sure, we'll talk all night. So I think with Marlon Brando, it was very much that. And he started by saying, don't ask me any questions about what was so-and-so really like and what were the movies like. And I went, okay, but of course he told me everything. You know, it had to be on his terms, but he would like divulge everything and just told the whole story. Anyone else?
Jim, yeah. You got the call from Tennessee, right? You wrote in the letter.
Yeah.
Did he call you then?
I was living at my parents' house in Baton Rouge.
Yeah.
I had decided I did not want to be an actor. And it was good because I wouldn't have been in Baton Rouge. I would have been here. And he would not have known how to get in touch with me. So I was at my parents' house in Baton Rouge. And I hadn't told anybody. Because I used to write letters to everybody, John. So I didn't tell anyone that I'd written this really heartfelt, vocational type letter to Tennessee Williams asking, I think I'd like to be a writer. You're my favorite writer. Talk to me. But I didn't tell anybody. So the phone rang one day and my mother came to the door. I just came from Baton Rouge and I was telling my mother about this. There's a look all of our mothers get, right? So my mother's at the door going, like, what are you up to? Someone claiming to be Tennessee Williams. And I went, oh, okay, it's probably a friend, or whatever. But it was Tennessee. And first thing he said, I said, hello, perhaps you can be of help to me. Okay. And he said, let's have lunch. And I said, where are you? And he says, I'm at the Royal Orleans Hotel. And I go, well, I'm in Baton Rouge and that's 80 miles away. He goes, well, you better hurry. So I literally got in my car and drove to New Orleans.
Right. So the amazing thing to me, I love the book so much, is that you get there, you're 20 years old, and you relate these conversations with Tennessee Williams are so amazingly dense and articulate, and they are obviously Tennessee Williams talking.
Well, I'll tell you how I got it.
How did you have the wherewithal to take the kind of notes that you took?
Well, this is a funny, the conversation that relates to an event that was not in this building, but was sponsored by the New York Society Library with Jonathan Siegel, a terrific editor. And one of his writers is Carl Bernstein. And my editor's office used to be next to Jonathan Siegel's. And I went up there to take drop off pages or something, I don't know what. And Carl Bernstein was there, whom I knew from waiting on at La Maison de Chocolat and the Metropolitan Museum bookstore, where I sold him a membership and got a commission. And of course, he had that look like, what, you're a salesperson. And I went, oh, well, I'm working on a book. And he's like, okay. And he asked for some samples. And I gave him some samples, and he took me to lunch. And he said, how'd you get these quotes? You know, like, I mean, I'm always on the Huskies, is it with the Huskies or the Huskies? Well, I forget what they call it.
Huskies.
Yeah, the Huskies. I'm always out there, and it's like, you're scribbling things or holding up a tape recorder, and it's like, how did you get these quotes? And I said, well, I'm going to tell you how I got the quotes. And of course, his head exploded because I violated every code. I show everybody everything, which is not what journalists should do. So when people ask me, how did you get these great quotes from all these people, I would write everything down. Tennessee even said at one point, I would like to see more than the part of your hair. But I would write everything down. I had my own version of shorthand. I would go home and immediately type it up. And then when I went back to Tennessee, I showed it to him. And he never said, take that out. He would just say, what I meant was, and it would deepen. And then that happened with everybody else. I can't do that anymore. I'm 54. So now I still write everything down, but I have a tape recorder. Because I'm not as fast. And I don't always get home immediately to type it up. But whatever I type up, I show. And of course, Carl Bernstein said, you can't do that. I go, well, why can't I do that? You can't do that. I go, well, I'm not following Hillary Clinton around. I mean, if I were following any presidential candidate or any political person, I would not show them what they said and give them the opportunity to go, that's not what I meant about ISIS. No, no, that's a whole different thing, in my opinion, than someone who's like divulging their entire life and what they feel about art and their relationship to Tennessee and so forth. And it's also, I felt I was canny because they always expanded, so it got better. So like when Marlon Brando said something really, not cruel, but not very flattering about Grace Kelly, for instance. Like he said, I was really happy winning an Oscar and Betty Davis gave it to me, and then they gave one to Grace Kelly. So it kind of put everything back into perspective. Well, he left it at that, and then he said, I have to expand on that. Grace Kelly was a lovely woman. So he went into more detail, so it wasn't just a swipe at Grace Kelly. But he didn't take out the term, you know, the phrase that would offend people who love Grace Kelly. So that's how I did it.
I'm sorry, just to follow up. Was there a reason why you didn't take the tape recorder? I forget.
I didn't have a tape recorder.
You didn't have a tape recorder.
Yeah, and plus I went there, well, the first day, I went there thinking, we're going to have an hour and a half lunch. He's going to say, write what you know, be full of feeling, blah, 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 and that's going to be it. I didn't know it was going to drag on, and then he could say, come back tomorrow. And maybe I would have if I had a tape recorder. Maybe I would have taken it. I don't know. phone pictures for everybody. Yes, I'm with this person, that person, but, you know, I didn't take a camera either. And but also walking around with Tennessee Williams in the French Quarter would be like walking with the Pope in Vatican City. Because people who were visiting couldn't believe, like, we got Tennessee Williams. And some of them even said, are you really Tennessee Williams or an actor dressed up to look like Tennessee? Somebody would say, I'm just an actor dressed up. And they gave him like $5. But this is more lucrative than playwright. but sometimes he would say, I am, and they would ask him questions, and he was so funny. He was like a stand-up comedian. I mean, this quote won't mean, well, it might mean to this crowd. It was hysterically funny in 1982. I'll try it. a young man walked up to Tennessee Williams, and he said, Mr. Williams, I'm a graduate student in philosophy at Tulane. And he went, you poor thing. And he says, well, I have an assignment. I'm asking people of a certain age. And he turned to me and said, that means old. I'm asking people of a certain age if they've gotten to this level in their life with all this experience, and they still have three things they just don't understand. They just can't comprehend it. And he went, yes. Deliberate cruelty, algebra, and Celeste Holm. So the guy like, okay. You know, then that led me to a discussion, which is back to knowing where to look, right? It's great to have a success. It's great to win an Academy Award. It's great to get a good review. It's great to have a date with someone you've idolized about forever. But that can't be the end all in everything. And he said, and also, because I used to waste a lot of time going, well, this really upset Tennessee terribly. He was told consistently that he was going to win the Pulitzer Prize for The Glass Menagerie. He said, don't ever listen to anyone when they tell you shit like this. Yeah. And he said, because the day came and my phone wasn't ringing, that's never a good sign. Finally, the phone did ring, and it was his mother. And she went, well, this is an outrage. He said, knowing my mother, I thought that meant I won. And he goes, well, Mom, is it, the winner of the Pulitzer Prize was Harvey, of the play about the imaginary rabbit. And Tennessee went, and suddenly I just laughed hysterically, like, I can never take this seriously again. You know, and but then when he won, it was wonderful. You don't remember that Harvey won. You just put that back. And then he says, and what was wonderful was he won the Pulitzer for Cow in a Hot Tin Roof. And he says, I was in the wonderful position of being told in the press that I didn't deserve it. So now I was Mary Chase of Harvey, like, no, it should have gone to someone else. So it's wonderful, but it's not, you have to know how to look at it. You know, sometimes it's just a cute person you made out with at the bar. Sometimes it's just a fluke that your play succeeded. Some, you know, two people may have prevented him from winning a Tony Award for Cow in a Hot Tin Roof. You just don't know, you know. So you have to be grateful for the experience. And that's what he was trying to teach me and himself at the same time, which is why he sent me to all these wonderful people to say, you matter to Tennessee, here's what he said. No, he mattered to you. He said, I was the canary in the coal mine of his need. And so that's what I was doing. Jim,
you know, you know how I feel about this book, and I love this book, and I love it especially because, to me, he was the greatest American playwright in the sense that he could get inside the mind and the heart and the soul of a woman like no other playwright, I think.
Yeah.
And so what I'm curious is, in terms of you in your life, what would you say was the most singular thing that he gave you, that he taught you, so that you could go forward with your own life?
Well, apropos what I was talking about at the beginning about now the mortal sin seems to be offending anyone. You are saying something that doesn't jive with what their calcified beliefs. He would always say, it is, producers and agents are going to say, well, what is your book or play like? So they can categorize it. So, I don't know, if you say, well, it's kind of like Bridges of Madison County meets Hamilton. You know, they might go, I'll take a meeting. But you're betraying yourself. Don't ever write anything but that one thing only you could write. And it may seem so bizarre and strange. strange, and the first people who read it might go, what is this? But that's what you have to be loyal to. And he said, and that's what my plays were like. People would go, oh, this is so depressing. You know, I'm like, this is not how mothers and their children talk to each other.
I did.
And I can't, it must be other families like this. You know, I mean, Tennessee said when he was starting to write plays, the theater was still very British. You know, even when it was an American play, like There Shall Be No Night, everyone said, it's very cold outside, isn't it? And it's like, and these were hugely successful plays. And he went, I don't know these people. I mean, I admire the talent that's on the stage, but I don't know these people. And he always said he broke the hymen on 20th century drama. He said, I took it away from Eugene O'Neill. Brilliant playwright, he was very much a 19th century playwright. He also said Stephen Sondheim broke the hymen on 20th century music. Mm-hmm. Because before that it was Rodgers and Hammerstein meets Romberg meets, you know, Hart. You know, he said we put darkness on that stage, and which is reality in Tennessee's words. So I think he just said to me, it's hard because you have to make a living, and you are in this time knot, which I didn't understand at 20. I so get it now. But we're all caught in this time knot of we feel like we have to make a name for ourselves, our own property, or something by this time in our lives. But you have to ignore that, and you have to write what only you can write. So I think that was the greatest thing that he taught me. He also said, don't get down. You have a tendency to depression. And he said, you can't do that, because you can always throw some words up in the air, and that's fabulous. But what a great gift we have. We can like throw words up in the air and like, boom, sentence. Because that's really magical. So I think that was the other thing. It's like, if all else fails, I can go and write. It may never see the light of day. Well, it'll be on Facebook, I guess. It'll see the light of a type of day. But that was a great gift you gave me. Anyone else?
One more question.
Yeah. Anyone? Okay. Oh, sure. Hi.
So it sounds like most of the interviews went very smoothly. Were there any interviews that were difficult?
Oh, yeah. But I'm trying to be a nice person. And I don't give out those names anymore. But I used to do that, and finally, it turned out that one of the women who was really horrible to me and was horrible to almost everyone in the world has a wonderful son with whom I've worked, and he said, she's my mom, and I felt really bad, so I don't. So I don't say Lauren McCall anymore. Stephen, mom. Okay, yeah.
Yeah, it was kind of along those lines. Did you end up getting to everyone that he or did?
Well, yes and no. I wanted to spend more time with Geraldine Page. And Geraldine Page I met on a visit to New York, and then we had several phone calls, and she said, when are you moving to New York? And I said, well, I don't know, and then she died before I got here. So I still got some good material from her, but I would have liked for that chapter to have been longer, because she fascinated me. But who else did I not get to? Well, then there are people who died, and I love how, again, people don't know their place in time. They go, what was Vivian Leigh like? She died when I was 6. Or did she talk to Lorette Taylor? No. You know, I mean, like, yes. So people criticize me on Facebook. I can't believe you wrote this book and didn't include Lorette Taylor. She died in 1946. I mean, she's mentioned in the